Right. Okay. So let's just begin. I'm Asha, and I'll be dealing with the oral surgical part of the. Generally, the oral surgery will take it in session-wise discussions. To begin with, today we'll see the general principles of oral surgery and questions related to that. So if you answered the question, the four questions that I've already sent, I've got multiple responses regarding that. By the end of the session, you should at least be able to understand those questions, okay? So to begin with, yes? Am I audible? Am I audible? Anybody can just unmute and say if I'm audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So basically, the general principles is the general principle of oral and maxillofacial surgery and general surgery. These both are combined. So any surgery, you have certain general principles, which begins with pre-surgical evaluation, which is nothing but your diagnosis, and is surgery really needed for that. So that is the pre-surgical evaluation, which we'll be seeing in detail in the subsequent sessions. As in when we deal the different lesions, trauma, pathology, this portion will be covered, the pre-surgical evaluation part. And again, asepsis, as you know, asepsis is nothing but the microbiological part, the sterilization and disinfection, the asepsis protocol, infection control, all that is under asepsis. So I'm not going to know the details of pre-surgical evaluation and asepsis right now. Let's just begin with pre-surgical preparation. Okay, so the pre-surgical preparation, basically it is just preparing the patient. That is, you just prepare the patient for the surgery. So basically, you'll have to get a proper medical workup done, his histories and all that, okay? So that, again, we are covering it in management of medically compromised patients. But in general, when you prepare a patient for surgery, it includes both physical preparation and the mental preparation. Physical preparation includes the regular medicines that he is taking, any prophylaxis that he needs, is he a known diabetic, and all that portion that I, as I said, will be covering later. And the mental protocol, like the anxiety reduction protocol, the MIDAS that we give, midazolam, all that includes the pre-surgical preparation. So I'm not going into the details of pre-surgical preparation, because from an MCQ point of view, there aren't much of a discussion in pre-surgical preparation. Just the basic thing. And I've just included the antibiotic prophylaxis for infective endocarditis. That is, you have to give 2 grams 1 hour before the procedure, either oral or IV. If it is oral, then you give amoxicillin. IV for amox is ampicillin. If a patient is allergic to beta-lactam antibiotics, then you go ahead with clindamycin or azithromycin. So this is just a basic to understand what exactly is pre-surgical evaluation and what all is accepted in that. So generally, when you have questions where you have a case-based scenario, all these things have to be taken into consideration. Now, having seen the pre-surgical evaluation, the most important part of a surgical principle is the surgical technique. So we are going to mainly focus on the surgical technique for today's discussion. This will include the various incisions, flap designs, wound closure, hemorrhage, and wound healing. So let me just begin with incisions. Incisions, as you know, it could be anything. It could be a mucosal incision or a skin incision. Whatever be the incision, there are certain basic instruments that are to be needed. Of course, we'll have a separate discussion on armamentarium. But then the incision, basically we have the sizes of blades, okay? From 10 to 23, if you can see in the picture, 10 is usually used for skin incisions. Number 11 is used for IND incision and drainage. 12 and 15 is used for the minor oral surgical procedures. Of the minor oral surgical procedures, 12 is mainly used for periodontal procedures. That is the mucogingival surgeries that take place. Whereas 15, and especially 15C, which is a modification of 15, it's a finer blade used for minor oral surgeries. And again, there's another question regarding this. where this portion of the blade is called as the belly of the blade. So the surgical blade belly, that's called as the belly of the blade, especially in skin incisions where the belly rests on the skin surface. Okay, so that is this is the different blades used in oral surgery. And oral surgery mainly it is 11, 12 and 15. 11 is both for skin and intraoral incision and drainage, 12 for mucogingival surgeries and 15 for minor oral surgeries. So having seen this, let's just see what exactly are the principles for an incision. Okay, so incision mainly should be perpendicular to the epithelial surface. That is one most important rule for an incision. And there are questions based on this where they ask the direction or the angulation of the blade. So the blade should always be at perpendicular angle. It should be at perpendicular to the epithelial surface, be it the skin or the mucous membrane, up to the bone. It should be perpendicular. What happens if you angulate the blade? If you angulate the blade, it results in what is called as a bias cut. You heard the bias in community, right? So this is also called as bias cut. Okay, so first and foremost rule is perpendicular to the epithelial surface. Second important rule is it should be a single incision. Never redo the incision. It should be a single flowing incision for the pre-planned incision that you have planned. Never give multiple incisions. If you are going to give multiple incisions, it results in tissue tags. So you should avoid that. That's the second rule, single flowing incision. And the third and the most important rule is that it should avoid any major structures in that area. For example, if you see here, can you, anybody just identify the nerve? It's the medial surface of the mandible.
Inferior alveolar.
The inferior alveolar nerve? It's on the medial surface. You can see the gingiva there. It's not inside the bone. It's abutting the bone on the lingual side. So it's the lingual nerve. If it was the inferior alveolar nerve, the illustration would have shown into the foramen and the lingula there. This is not into the foramen, it's touching the mandible on the medial aspect.
So, inferior alveolar but lingual foramen ke through jaati hai. Ye hame dikhati
nahi hai, ki na?
Wo dikhti nahi hai, wo inferior alveolar lingual foramen ke andar se jaati
hai. Inferior alveolar.
So this is the lingual nerve, which they have shown the normal anatomy and altered anatomy. Usually the lingual nerve is about 5 millimeters below the gingival margin on the medial surface. But what happens in some cases, in some altered anatomy, normal anatomy cases, anatomical variation as we call it, may be very close. Please just unmuted your Pratishtha, is it? Do you want to say something? Okay, fine. Yeah, so in some cases, it is very close to the marginal gingiva. So what happens is, if you're going to give a vertical incision in these areas, it's going to affect the lingual nerve. It's going to injure or damage the lingual nerve. So the third most important rule of an incision is that it should be parallel to the important structures. It should never go perpendicular to the structures. So I've told you 3 points regarding this: perpendicular to the epithelial surface, one stroke incision, and third is parallel to the important structures in that area. So the, here we have represented the lingual nerve, where on the lingual side of the mandible, if you're going to raise a flap, never give a vertical incision. Similarly, if you're going to give a vertical incision in the posterior palate, again, it is contraindicated in posterior palate. Can anybody tell me why? Why is a vertical incision on the palate, why is it contraindicated in the posterior palate? See, we have the greater palatine vessels there. Okay, so if you're going to injure the greater palatine vessels, there will be severe hemorrhage in that region. So that's never give an incision, vertical incision on the lingual side and on the posterior palate, considering the important structure in these regions. Also, never give incision over bony prominences or any root prominences. For example, if you have the canine teeth, the canine prominence is very prominent on the bone. and you should never place a vertical incision right on the root prominence, because what happens if you're going to place it there, it will result in dehiscence, wound dehiscence. So always consider these places, okay? Whenever you are given a question regarding incision, just see if it is involving any important structures in that area, okay? So accordingly, you can find the answer for that. We, now, having seen the intraoral incision design, incision principles, we are going to see the flap design, intraoral flap design, okay? So as I said, whenever possible, there are certain flap principles we follow. Or does anybody have something to say? Okay, you want me to repeat once, is it? Yeah, I can repeat. My connection is unstable. One second. Can you hear me? Am I clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, do you want me to repeat the incision part, the concept, the synopsis of what I said in the incision part? Is it clear? I'll just repeat the incision part once. You have to give it perpendicular to the epithelial surface, parallel to the important structure, and one incision. So that's about the incision part. Coming on to the flap design, see, again, there are certain principles that whenever you take a flap design, see, one that we use for the mandibular third molars is the Ward's incision, W-A-R-D, Ward's incision. And those that we take it for other areas, these are actually classified into different types. You have the envelope flaps, you have the trapezoid flap, you have the triangular flap. You have different types of flaps, okay? So whichever be the flap, there are certain principles that whenever you take a flap, the incision, the vertical incision should rest on healthy bone. It should include the healthy bone around the defect that you're planning to expose. Secondly, avoid giving an incision through the interdental papilla. The incision should never go through the interdental papilla. Okay, because if you're going to involve the interdental papilla, it will, the infection of the papilla is lost.
Please mute yourself.
I think somebody is unmuted.
Yeah, I will mute. Dr. Asha, please unmute yourself only.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes. I have muted everyone. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So when you see the flap design, the as I said, there are various principles. One is never include the interdental, never place the incision on the interdental papilla. Because if you're going to put the incision right through the interdental papilla, there's going to be a pedial defect. Either you include the papilla in the flap or exclude it. Never put the incision on the papilla. Okay? And as much as possible, if that area is not included, try to exclude the papilla and leave it in the unraised mucosa. Okay, so that is one thing. Second thing, the base of the flap should be always be wider than the apex of the flap. That is, the base is the upper portion, whereas the apex is those the cervical area. So the base of the flap should be wider, because this is for the adequate vasculature and blood supply to the flap. Never constrict the vertical releasing incision. Initially, if you're giving a horizontal incision, the vertical incision should be at an angle of 45 degrees to the horizontal incision. So that's how the incision is planned. And just remember the angulations, 45 degree angulation of the vertical incision, base wider than the apex. And again, never take an incision through the interdental papilla. So these are the main points in this. And then coming on to the different types of flaps. As I said, this was already, that you saw was a trapezoidal flap. Now in this, if you reduce one vertical releasing incision, that becomes a triangular flap. According to the need for the surgery and the area to be accessed, we just alter the flap, because most important part in any surgical principle is that you should have a clear field for surgery, you should have adequate access and proper lighting. So based on this, you raise a flap that gives you a proper access. And this is an envelope flap. That is, in this flap, there is no releasing incision. There's just the horizontal releasing incision. And as I said, if you want to raise the exposure level, the access, then you can give a vertical releasing incision excluding the papilla, not on the papilla, at an angle of 45 degrees. So that's about the flap. And this is a modification. It's called as a Loeb-Oschenbein flap. Okay, in this, what is the benefit is that you leave the marginal gingiva and the attached gingiva. So there's going to be no bony defect, no dehiscence, no alteration of the papilla. It's all going to stay intact. The incision is the horizontal incision is not going to be into the sulcus, but into the attached gingiva. That is at the mucogingival junction, the junction of the attached and the free mucosa. That's going to be the margin between the for the vertical incision. It's called as the Loeb-Oschenbein incision, very important for periapical surgeries. So coming on now, we have seen enough and more about the mucosal incisions, and we're coming into the skin incisions. Skin incisions, the most important thing is to know about the Langer's lines when it comes to the face and the whole body. Langer's lines, that is L-A-N-G-E-R, Langer's lines are nothing but these are also called as the resting skin tension lines. That is R-S-T-L, resting skin tension lines. So the Langer's lines are also called as R-S-T-L, resting skin tension lines. And these lines are, they run parallel to the skin crease. That is, when I frown my eyebrows, if this is the skin crease, these lines run parallel to the skin crease, but at the same time, they are perpendicular to the underlying musculature. Okay? Do you get it? That is, the skin crease, it is parallel to the skin crease, but the underlying facial musculature, that is the muscles of facial expression, when you see, they are perpendicular to the Langer's lines. So that's how it is designed. Because when you give an incision, there's a gaping of wound. That occurs because the muscles are perpendicular to the Langer's line. So these are the Langer's line and very important for skin incisions. So these are some of the skin incisions that are commonly given in oral and maxillofacial surgery. Most common being the submandibular incision. It's also called as the Risdon's incision. R-I-S-D-O-N, Risdon's incision, which is given about 2 centimeters from the lower border of the mandible. This is done. So now I'll be telling you the name of the incision and the structure which is involved with it. That is the most common structure that will be encountered there. That is anatomical landmark of the pointers, main pointers there. So if it is a Risdon's incision, that is a submandibular incision, the nerve that will be encountered is the marginal mandibular nerve. Okay, branch of facial nerve. The marginal mandibular nerve is encountered, and one has to be very careful when dissecting through for the Risdon's approach. That is the submandibular approach. Next comes the retromandibular approach. Again, this is used to access the angle of the mandible and the condyle. It's also called as the Hind's approach. H-I-N-D, Hind's approach. Okay, so we have spoken about the Risdon incision and the Hind's incision. Coming on to the preauricular incision. As the name suggests, preauricular incision rests in front of the ear. And the most common nerve encountered there is the auriculotemporal nerve and the facial nerve. Because the facial nerve, as you know, starts branching in front of the ear. You have the pretragal markings to mark the facial nerve branching. So the most common nerve encountered in this incision is the auriculotemporal nerve and the buccal branch of facial nerve. The facial nerve is commonly encountered. So another most common incision used is that it's called as the Alcaide-Bramley modification of preauricular incision. It is a question mark shaped incision. If you can see, the incision is in the shape of a question mark, and this is mainly used for TMJ ankylosis surgery. Surgery where TMJ ankylosis is released, this type of flap is used. It's called as the Alcaide-Bramley incision. It's a question mark shaped incision, and it's a modification of the preauricular incision. Now, coming to the lid incision, there are certain incisions which are given in the infraorbital region to access the zygoma and the maxillary anterior maxillary region. So these are called as the subciliary incisions or the infraorbital incision. The infraorbital incision, the lateral limit is mainly limited by the lymphatic drainage of the face. So the lateral one-third of the, that is beyond the lateral vertical from the pupil, if you draw a pure vertical, lateral to it you have the drainage of the lymphatic system, and if there is any blockade in that, then the lymphatic drainage gets obstructed, and there's an edema that rests here even post-op. Maybe after 1 month post-surgery you might still have an existing edema there. So that is a main limiting factor when considering an infraorbital incision, and that has to be taken into account while giving an infraorbital incision. So these are the facial incisions. And one more important incision is the Weber-Ferguson's incision. Okay, the Weber-Ferguson incision, as you can see, the red line is the line of the incision. Basically, even the infraorbital component, if it is not there, it's called as the Weber-Ferguson incision. That is, along the lateral wall of the nose, it extends and splits the upper lip. So that's the Weber-Ferguson incision, mainly given for tumors of the maxillary sinus and maxilla. If you approach the maxilla for any other reason, then you can give a Weber-Ferguson incision, which is actually aesthetically quite acceptable for the condition. And one last skin incision that I'm discussing here is the rachitectomy incision. These are mainly used for cosmetic facial procedures like the facelift surgeries, those that they are carried out. This is called as a rachitectomy incision and gives quite a lot of exposure. One main structure that is encountered and is usually sacrificed in this incision is the greater auricular nerve. Greater auricular nerve is sacrificed during the surgery, this incision, rachitectomy approach. So that these are the basic skin incisions and some of them and the related structures and nerves that has to be kept in mind. So having done with the incision, next, a bit about the tissue dissection. Once the incision is given, there are certain layers. You would have read about the superficial and deep cervical fascia. In the face, there's a layer called as the SMAS layer, superficial musculoapeneuritic system. It's called as SMAS layer. They generally say that when you dissect, if you're along the SMAS layer, then the amount of bleeding that occurs and the amount of post-op edema that occurs is very minimal. This is a terminology that they keep asking, SMAS layer, it's called a superficial musculoapeneuritic system, SMAS. So SMAS layer, that's about the tissue dissection. Okay, so once we do the dissection, then it depends, okay, as such, or like whatever surgery that we'll discuss in each and every topic when we do what surgery and what is the treatment plan for each and every condition. But now, as we are discussing the general principle, let's just see a bit about wound closure and wound healing. Most commonly used technique for wound closure is suturing. Anywhere, any place, if there is a wound, surgical wound, then we do a suturing. Even if it is a traumatic wound, we go in and do a suturing for that. So basically, before going into the suturing principles, we'll have to see a bit about the suture needles. Okay. So if you see the suture needles, if you see the suture needles, you can basically classify them into two types. Either you can call it, based on the material, they are classified as stainless steel and carbon steel suture needles. And again, based on their shape, they're classified as straight and curved. And if it is a curved suture needle, there are four types in that. 1/2, 1/4. These two are easy to remember, 1/4 and 1/2. And then you have 3/8 and 5/8. So the four types of curved suture materials, curved suture needles available are 1/2, 1/4, 3/8 and 5/8. Of these, the most commonly used in mucogingival procedures or any minor oral surgery or facial surgery in general is the 5/8 needle. Okay, this is based on the shape. Now again, based on the cross section, if you cut the needle, it could be either round. It's called as a round-bodied needle. The benefit of this needle is when you take bite through certain places, like if you are taking through a very thin tissue or through a tendon, if you're going to use a cutting needle, something like this with a triangle section, it will just tear through the muscle and come out. So we don't want that. So that you have a round body needle. So if there's a question where they ask, what type of suture needle will you use for a muscle or a tendon closure, then you choose round bodied material. Okay. But if you have a question based on skin and mucosa, then you go in for reverse cutting. Actually, both conventional cutting and reverse cutting can be used for mucosa and skin. But one advantage of reverse cutting over conventional cutting is that the base of the triangle is away from the incision line. That is the base of the incision, the flat part of the triangle is facing the incision. So what happens is when you pull, the suture doesn't tear off and come with, like, it doesn't tear the flap. So that is a benefit of the reverse cutting suture. This is basically about the suture needles available. And as I said, 5x8 is most commonly used in minor oral surgeries. Now, having seen the suture needles, let's just have a look at the suture materials. Suture materials can be classified either as absorbable or non-absorbable. Most common and conventional material in absorbable sutures is catgut. You would have all heard about catgut. Catgut is it's obtained from a natural origin. It's obtained from either sheep's intestinal submucosa. There are questions where they have asked whether it is submucosa or mucosa. So it's sheep's intestinal submucosa or bovine intestinal serosa. So these are the two derivatives, places from where we get the plain catgut. But one problem with the catgut is that it's got less tensile strength. It will hold the wound only for about 2 to 3 days. After that, it will just give way. Okay. And one more thing regarding catgut is that when you buy a pack of catgut, it is stored in isopropyl alcohol. No other suture material is preserved in isopropyl alcohol except catgut and chromic catgut. So whenever you're using these sutures, it's very important to wash the suture in saline before placing it in the patient's mouth. Okay, so isopropyl alcohol is the preservative used for catgut. And if you're going to place a catgut suture in saline for more than 2 hours, just dip it in saline for the procedure and just leave it like that, it is going to lose its inherent properties. So never keep the suture in saline for more than 2 hours. So that's about catgut. Catgut, as I said, it holds the wound only for 2 to 3 days. So what happens is they brought the chromic catgut where they, like the leathers, they go for tannery industries. They just tanned the catgut with chromium. So it was called as chromic catgut. So the origin is same for chromic catgut. That is also a resorbable suture, but it holds the wound for a longer time, maybe 5 to 7 days. So that's the difference between plain catgut and the chromic catgut. Okay. Apart from this, we have another important material, which is called as polyglycolic acid or polyglactin. It is commercially known as Vicryl, V-I-C-R-Y-L, Vicryl. Okay, so that is as we discussed catgut and chromic catgut, these two are monofilament. That is, they are a single filament and it is not braided. Okay, basically the suture materials can also be classified as monofilament and braided materials. So catgut and chromic catgut are monofilament, whereas polyglycolic acid, that is the Vicryl that I said, PGA sutures or polyglactin 910, that's what they're called. These are braided materials. Okay. These are the absorbable materials. Now coming on to the non-resorbable materials. Most common material used is silk, braided silk. I think many places they write it as BBS, braided black silk. So that's how they write in the case sheets. So that's easier to remember, braided black silk. So that's the most common material I think we all use in the in our clinical setups. So the braided black silk, as I said, is a braided material. It is, though it is classified as a non-resorbable material, it disintegrates in about 2 years' time. That is, if you put a ligature, if an artery is bleeding, you put a ligature and leave it, it disintegrates after 2 years. But it is still considered as a non-resorbable material. Now, as we spoke about the resorbable materials, catgut and chromic catgut, there's one more important point there. Catgut, it breaks down by proteolytic degradation and phagocytosis. That's the mechanism of breakdown of catgut. Okay. Whereas this polyglactin, the PGA material, that breaks down by disintegration. So that is the difference in the, here there's a phagocytosis mechanism happening. So there's more of tissue reaction in a cat gut compared to a polylactic acid, that is the vital material. So again, coming to non-resorbable, so silk is most commonly used for intraoral procedures, whereas nylon, it's a monofilament material, that is more commonly used for skin. Apart from this, you have something called as Dacron sutures, D-A-C-R-O-N, Dacron sutures. These are polyester sutures. These are also non-resorbable and they also use for skin. So basically for skin, you use a monofilament, and for mucosa, you use a braided. Why? Because in the mucosa, it's already the saliva is there, and the mucosa is, the consistency of mucosa is such that if you're using a monofilament, it will just slip, the knot will just slip there, okay? And braided will just hold it together. So always remember, for an intraoral procedure, use a monofilament. You can use a braided, and for skin, go for a monofilament. If there is a question based like that, you can choose accordingly whether a monofilament or a polyfilament, braided material is available. So these are the various suture materials. Suture materials can also be classified based on the thickness of the material, the thread thickness. That is, they are classified from 0 to 10-0. Okay, O, which either called 0 or O sutures, 1-0, 2-0, 3-0, up to 10-0. As the number increases, as it goes till 10-0, the thickness actually decreases. It's inversely proportional. That is, the 10-0 is very fine. It is as fine as a hair, used for very microscopic surgeries. Whereas 1-0, 2-0 is very huge, used for scalp and thick skin. So that's how it is graded. For intraoral procedures, that is mucosal procedures, we generally use 3-0 silk or Vicryl, or 4-0. 3-0 or 4-0 is used for intraoral procedures. And for skin, facial skin is very delicate. So we go in for 5-0 or 6-0. 5-0 or 6-0 material. These are the types of material used in different parts of the face and mouth. Now, having seen the suture materials, we'll just see the different suturing principles that are present, okay? The suturing principle, again, as I said, the blade has to go perpendicular to the skin. Similarly, the needle should also enter perpendicular to the skin. Never bend the needle, no angulation, nothing. It always enters perpendicular to the skin. And the bite is usually taken from a weaker segment to a stronger segment. For example, we take it from a mobile tissue to a fixed tissue. Thinner skin to a thicker skin. Deep to superficial. That's how the bite is taken. And when it comes to the oral mucosa and extraction socket, we generally take it from papilla to papilla. Never take a bite in the marginal gingiva. So it's usually papilla to papilla. And the distance of the bite from the incision margin, that is, if you take the incision margin, the distance of the margin from the bite is usually 2 mm. Okay, 2 to 3 mm. And distance between two sutures should be 3 to 4 mm. So these are certain numerical values there. So these are the basic suturing principles. One more thing is that when you close a wound, sometimes what happens is at the one end of the wound, there is a overlap. It's called as a dog ear. Okay, so if you want a correction of dog ear, then we give an angulated incision at 30 degree angles to the parent incision and then close the wound. Then what happens is that excess tissue gets corrected. So that's the dog ear correction with a 30 degree angulated incision. These are the suturing principles. The different types of sutures, the suturing methods are the simple interrupted suture. This is used for areas where there is tension. Mild tension, use a simple interrupted. Severe tension, use a vertical mattress suture. Okay. Now, coming on to the continuous suture, where you take a continuous run, you have the simple continuous and the locking interrupted continuous. You have the locking continuous type. So these two, benefit of these two is that they give watertight closure. A continuous suture always gives a watertight closure. And then coming on to the horizontal mattress suture should be given above a bone graft. If you are placing a bone graft, give a horizontal mattress, because the amount of approximation is more. If you give an interrupted suture, the approximation occurs at a pinpoint. But when you give a horizontal mattress, there's a uniform approximation of the entire mucosa in that region. So that's the suture methods that I use. And again, for suturing of an extraction socket, we use the figure of eight suture. Figure of eight suture for extraction wounds. So these are the basic suturing principles that we should know. Now, as I said, one more thing, that is, once the suturing, we have seen the principles, there is something called a suture knot. There are three types of knot. We have the surgeon's knot, granny knot, and a square knot. But the most suitable is a surgeon's knot. Always go in for a surgeon's knot, where you take two clockwise throws and one anti-clockwise throw. That is a surgical knot. So that is the one which is advisable. And regarding the suture removal for intraoral wounds can be done from 5 to 7 days. Skin wounds from 3 to 5 days. Skin, we have a specific method for closure called as subcuticular incision. So if it is a subcuticular incision, then wait for 10 days. Again, if the incision or if the wound is in areas where it will not heal properly or it's on bony prominences, then we wait for 10 days or even longer for suture removal. The intraoral, 5 to 7, skin, 3 to 5, subcuticular, 5 to 10. So these are the days, number of days when the suture removal has to be done. So this is regarding the suture removal. Now, considering the tissue reaction, what they say is that suture actually helps to hold the tissue together. They say that if you're going to leave the suture longer than normal, then it has got 10,000 times more potential for causing an infection. That is, the suture that we have given to close the wound itself could promote an infection if it is left for longer. And how much times more is that? It is 10,000 times more prone. Okay, so this is one point that you should remember. Now, having seen this, there are other techniques for wound closure. Like, you have the skin adhesives. It's called as N-butyl cyanoacrylate. The one that we use intraorally is called as N-butyl cyanoacrylate. And that actually helps to, the N-butyl cyanoacrylate can approximate just like a glue, something like a skin glue where you put the wound together and put the glue over that. It is aesthetically very acceptable, but not suitable for gaping wounds, gaping injuries. Gaping is when it just flares open. In those cases, skin glue would not stand. So that's about the skin adhesives. Then you also have Steri-Strips. These are actually adhesive tapes where you just put the incision together and put a tape, a sterile tape over it. That is also warranted in some cases. But if the wound is deep, then there is no better alternative to suturing. So these are the various wound closure techniques that are available. Now, having seen the wound closure, just before closing the wound, if you're expecting an edema in certain places or a swelling or something that is going to obstruct the structures inside, then it is always better to place a drain. So drain, there are various types of drains, where you have the most common one is the corrugated rubber drain, where just a rubber sheet, like thing, baby rubber sheet, which you just place it in the wound and suture it. One disadvantage is that it keeps leaking into the dressing and the dressing gets soaked, and there's sort of a lot of inconvenience because of that and infection because of a soaked dressing. So for a simple wound, you can anyway go in for a corrugated rubber drain or a glove drain. Even the glove that you use can be used as a drain. That is a warranted method. So these are simple drains. And again, you have tube drain and Penrose drain. These are also for simple wounds. And one more thing is a wick drain, W-I-C-K, wick, wick drain. This is nothing but when you have an intraoral abscess, you drain. Generally, some people, they place a gauze piece inside and suture it and leave it for 2 to 3 days. For the gauze piece itself will act as a drain. So that is called as a wick drain, W-I-C-K, wick drain. So these are the regular normal drains for smaller wounds that we use. Major drains after major oral surgical procedures, these are called as negative suction. These are called as negative suction drains, where what happens is there's a tube. As you can see in the first picture, the tube is inserted into the wound and there is a pump-like thing here that creates negative suction. That is, once you press the pump and connect the tube, as the pump goes out, it just collects the edema and fluid in. It's called as a negative suction drain. So it's used. It's commonly used in head and neck surgeries, where it creates a negative pressure. It's like a suction. Like how you have a chair suction to suction out something, the tube there is going to act as a suction. This has been asked. They have put pictures in the question paper, the picture of the drain, and they've asked what type of drain it is. It's called as a negative pressure drain. apart from this, you also have something called as a sump drain. That is not commonly used in head and neck. It's used more in the gastroenterological surgeries, where you have holes in the tube so that the tissue doesn't get stuck into the tube. So that's a sump drain, commonly used for gastro procedures. So these are the various types of drains that are commonly used. For a normal intraoral procedure, we generally use a wick drain, that is a gauze in situ, or we use a corrugated rubber drain. Okay. For major surgeries, we go in for a negative pressure suction drain. So these are the drains that are used. And then, so ideally, I think you would have gone through wound healing. Wound healing, either it occurs by primary intention or secondary intention. Wound closures so far that we have been talking about, that is the sutures, the adhesive, skin adhesive, that is N-butyl cyanoacrylate, and the steri-strips that we are going to use, all these are bringing about healing by primary intention. There are some cases where there is too much tension, and in that case, there is no point in putting the wound together and tying it like a gunny bag. It is not going to work. So in that case, we just leave it open like a secondary healing by secondary intention. So in those cases, we use certain dressings just to allow healing in that area. These dressings are called as iodoform gauze dressings or BIPP, bismuth iodoform paraffin paste, or you would have heard about whitehead varnish. Whitehead varnish is a combination of iodoform, tolu, balsam of tolu, and styrax liquid. So these three together makes the whitehead varnish, which is used for secondary healing intention, healing by secondary intention, where the wound is left open, something after a maxillectomy, where there's severe tissue loss, severe oral mucosa loss, and it cannot be covered, then we go in for a whitehead varnish dressing. So that is about the dressings. And then, as I said, any surgery has its complications. You have a hemorrhage, you have three types of hemorrhage, like you have a primary hemorrhage, you have a reactionary hemorrhage, and a secondary hemorrhage. So primary hemorrhage is one that occurs during surgery. Reactionary hemorrhage is one that occurs within 24 hours of surgery. And secondary hemorrhage occurs, that it is the one, secondary hemorrhage occurs in a post, maybe after a week, 7 to 10 days, that is the secondary hemorrhage. So primary hemorrhage, we control it during the surgery. Reactionary hemorrhage occurs when there is, in that too, within the first 24 hours, the first 6 hours is more crucial for this reactionary hemorrhage to occur. When it occurs, when there is a clot dislodgement, or there is a ligature slipping, that is if you have ligated an artery and it just slips off, all that comes under reactionary hemorrhage. And secondary hemorrhage occurs when there is an infection, breakdown on the wound, and there is a hemorrhage, then it causes a secondary hemorrhage. So that's the secondary hemorrhage. Okay, so these are the various hemorrhage types, and most common methods used for hemostasis are pressure pack is the number one method used for hemorrhage at any site, that is for intraoral procedures especially. Then comes your ligation, artery ligation, ECA ligations, and all that. And certain agents like styptic agents are also used for suturing, obviously. And certain materials are used, like tranexamic acid is a styptic commonly used, ethamsylate is used, then you have streptochrome, ferric chloride, all these are used for styptic agent, that is the control of bleeding in that site. Now, having seen a bit about the hemorrhage, we just end the session with wound healing. Okay, so wound healing, as I said, you could have wound healing by primary intention, secondary intention. Primary, as you know, there's a regeneration, that is, there's a regeneration versus repair. So, regeneration is the lost tissue is replaced by the same tissue or identical, similar tissue. Or if it is replaced by a granulation tissue, then it is called as healing by secondary intention. So depending on what type of closure we have achieved, we either expect a primary healing or a secondary healing to occur. So granulation, there are various processes of wound healing. There are four processes. Number one is inflammation. Number two, wound contraction. Number three, epithelialization. And number four is finally the wound, granulation tissue formation. So what happens? Granulation tissue forms both in primary and secondary, but the amount of granulation tissue in secondary is more than the primary. Having seen about the wound healing, finally we'll end on a note with the factors affecting wound healing. Okay, the various factors which affect wound healing, it could be some nutritional deficiencies. Okay, nutritional deficiency like vitamin A deficiency delays epithelialization. Vitamin C deficiency again delays collagen synthesis. Again, if the patient has a protein starvation, it will delay the wound healing. Corticosteroids has a dual role. Actually, there are generally they say that corticosteroid delays healing, but it does not apply to all corticosteroids. If the corticosteroid is an anabolic corticosteroid, like if it's a testosterone or a desoxy corticosterone, in these cases, what happens is the wound healing is pronounced. So we have to actually look into what type of steroid it is. Again, if the patient is on chemotherapy or any immunomodulator, the healing is delayed. So whenever you're considering wound healing, these are certain factors that has to be taken into account to consider if the wound healing is going to be adequate or not. So with this, we'll end the session right now. Like we are finished with wound healing and the general principles of surgery. I'm just posting another questionnaire now. I would like one by one, if you could just, it is based on what we have discussed now. If you can just answer one by one, we'll just end it with that. It's just about 7 questions. We'll just, if you can just answer that, we'll answer that and end the session. Okay, so I've got the questions here. Can anyone just unmute and read the first question for me? Hello?
Longer presence of sutures increases the chance of infection by 10,000 times, 100 times, or more.
1 lakh times. So what is the answer?
100 times.
It's 10,000 times. Longer presence of suture increases the chance of infection by 10,000 times. Right? Thank you. Good try. Yeah, next question. Was that Barkha who just answered?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can anybody else unmute and just read the second question?
Lagar lines usually run
parallel. It's there in your pretest also, I think, right?
Parallel to skin crease and perpendicular to underlying muscle.
Very good. Manisha. Very good, Manisha. That's the correct answer. It runs parallel to skin crease and perpendicular to underlying muscle. Okay. Third question. Okay, this thing I have not discussed so far. Let me see if you can just answer. Maximum strength of surgical wound obtained after 3 weeks is?
70%.
3 months is 70%. That's why I've changed the question. Okay. So in 10 days, you reach 10%. Okay. In 3 weeks, you reach 25% of the original tensile strength. And in 3 months, you reach 70%.